This show is brought to you by Slice on Broadway, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza, sliceonbroadway.com. And listeners like you, support this show at patreon.com/awesomecast.
Sidekick Media Services. We are your sidekick in business for social media, video production, and more. Find out more at sidekickmediaservices.com.
Hey guys, it's time to talk tech, get geeky. It's the AwesomeCast episode 338. I'm Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on the Twitter here in the Mayhem Studios in Pittsburgh, PA. And we got a couch full. First with us is John Chilla at Chilla on the Twitter. He's a gadget guru at Big Bank International Incorporated Esquire.
How's it going today?
All right.
It's good to be back in the studio.
Yes, and also back with us again, making illicit technology deals, is Katie Dudders at K Dudders on the Twitter.
I got technology you want to buy.
Wink.
Cash only.
Social media guru over at the Scare House. America's scariest haunt. What's the tagline? What's your tagline?
Well, it's Pittsburgh's ultimate haunted house.
Oh, that's right. It was something like that.
I liked America better.
Yeah, we were America, but then it just gets kind of weird, and everybody's like, I'm the best, and I'm the best, and we're the best in Pittsburgh. So
Earth's
we are the only
haunt.
One that matters.
So Earth's greatest haunt, yes. Believe me. Believe and that. Also with us is a real journalist, Kim Lyons.
I don't know what he meant by that.
I think I just got burned.
Wow.
Yeah, what? We're just podcasters. We're just here. And we got... Kim Lyons is joining us. Kim, where are you these days?
Where am I? I'm in the lovely borough of Dormont. Coming to you live from Dormont.
Excellent.
I'm everywhere, a little bit everywhere. Wait, a little bit
of spread. Are you at Studio paper. B or C or D? Okay.
Also, I have my own podcast, but I don't know if it's like kosher to plug your podcast on someone else's podcast.
No, of course it is. That gives you street cred with the kids.
All right. I have three whole episodes. We're on iTunes. We even have a review on iTunes. How about that?
Cool.
Hey, drop those reviews. Check it out. What's it called?
Exciting.
What's the name of the podcast?
It's the Broadcast Podcast. It's a podcast focused on women and women's voices. We're put the broad and broadcast, kind of our motto. So it's about amplifying women's voices, women doing cool stuff in Pittsburgh. You know, getting the word out that women are doing the work. So
there you go. Check it out. Well, and this is your Awesome Cast. Like I said, you can check out everything at awesomecast.net. You can check us out and subscribe and leave a comment for us too over on iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, iHeartRadio, video versions on the Facebook and the YouTube pages for the show. And you can join us here live every Tuesday when the technology works at live.awesomecast.net around 7 p.m. Eastern time. And also we're streaming over at riversagepgh.com thanks to them. And very soon we will be streaming on a new outlet. I think that's going to start this week. So look out for news on that on the Twitters and everything to see where we're going to end up. Yes. And also you can support the show over on patreon.com/awesomecast and help the show grow. And we got some cool stuff for you guys over there.
And I think you should change it from support us to adopt us.
Adopt the podcast over at patreon.com/awesomecast. like our good friends, Matt Weller at the coffee club level of $5 and Mike Fedor at the $1 fan of the show level. Thank you so much, guys. Long time followers and contributors to the show. We really do appreciate you guys being a part of it and contributing to that. And you don't have to just share the show, comment wherever you may listen to us or watch us. And we appreciate all the feedback for that. So let's get into our awesome things of the week. And geez, I don't even know where to start on this one. There's a lot of stuff going on. That's pretty great. Chilla.
That's me.
Let's start with VR. VR is always a good spot.
So Samsung, obviously Mobile World Congress is this week. All the mobile companies, LG, Samsung, Sony, etc., are announcing some of their new tech. Samsung has put their next phone, that announcement on hold till the end of the month. and kind of segregating that almost like Apple does from a World Congress. But one of the things they did announce in addition to their new tablet, or their new tablets, actually, I guess, Tabli, is a controller for the Gear VR, which they actually, to me, it looks pretty darn nice, and it's going to be reminiscent of what you see with the Oculus, because they developed it in partnership with Oculus. The device does kind of have a very nice grip. It's powered by two AAA batteries. I'm excited for this because I'm still using my Gear VR from time to time, and I would love for this to be another way to navigate. I do find myself constantly having to look around the screen and tap on the side. I'm hoping that this kind of changes how that works.
Yeah, and for you guys on audio, it's kind of like a pointer with the kind of looks like a trackpad kind of thing on the end of it and a few buttons. So it's comparable a little bit to what you have for the Vive, right?
Yes. It has a plus and minus button, the home button, the back button, the typical buttons you kind of have on the side. And then I'm guessing the directional is kind of the D-pad that you also have.
In comparison, for me to solve this problem, I bought like the most generic gamepad, Bluetooth gamepad I could that would work on Android devices. And it seems to work pretty okay. So, but you know, I mean, it's not as great as like those kind of pointer devices. I mean, this isn't going to do the tracking like a Vive, right? Mm-hmm. Like maybe there'll be some accelerometer in it, perhaps.
Volume rocker home, clear texture trigger.
Is it more just buttons and interface?
Circular touch areas larger than the Daydream controller. Directional click pad underneath. That it doesn't say.
I wouldn't imagine, since this is the lower end kind of VR experience. So
I was kind of bummed because they haven't announced a price yet, but I also haven't purchased the newer, thinner, lighter Gear VR headset. But I'm interested to see what they're going to do and how this will come as a bundled package. I'm sure this will be part of their overall announcement at the end of the month. But it is nice to see that they're continuing to expand that market, especially as the NBA is getting more involved in streaming. I think we're going to see more and more streaming content that could be virtual reality related. So I'm very excited that they continue down the path, and I'm interested to see what more they come out with.
Okay. Yeah. It's good to see this. Again, this is kind of like the most accessible part of this. Mm-hmm. Although there was a Twitter, somebody was talking about, or no, I was listening to Double Fine's interview on Triangulation, I think. And they were talking about, the VR headsets, and it sounds like the Sony one is the biggest seller so far, which makes sense. Again, the most accessible one. I have a game console, I have a headset, you plug in, you go, versus a terribly high barrier of entry if you want to do anything with the Oculus or the Vive, or having a Samsung phone with this even gets a little, it can be complicated if you're not already in that world, right?
And what I wonder too is, though, because of the price point of the headset and the typical churn of someone's phone, I wonder what this will do to the resale market. Will we see more older devices still around the house? Because now it gives you, okay, I had the Samsung Galaxy S6 and I bought the S8. Now I'm just going to leave the S6 in my headset.
I'm still perfectly happy, you know, poking around with
S6. You have Galaxy, the S6, yeah. Yep. And that was one of my favorites because it still had the infrared port on it, so you could use it to control all your stuff in your house or go to the bar and really upset people.
I've been wanting to bring it along with me so I can shut off the TV at Sheets whenever they have something I don't want on, so I really would rather not hear. So, Kim, let's hear awesome thing of the week.
My awesome thing of the week is I did a story about a girl developer, local female-oriented developers group. They actually had an initiative she wasn't a member, but she is now, to get a group of public school kids to go see Hidden Figures because they wanted to, you know, get kids, especially young girls, to be able to see, hey, look, this is what developers look like. This is, you know, if you can't see it, you can't be it, is kind of the philosophy. And some other, you know, a developers group had done this in other areas. And so they did it, and they ended up raising twice as much money through a GoFundMe as they had initially planned on, and they took like 700 kids to go to a movie on President's Day to see Hidden Figures, which I thought was really an awesome way to introduce kids to tech who might not otherwise see themselves in that role, you know? So I was really impressed. I wrote a story about it. And even after I wrote the story for the trip, they raised, like, they doubled the money that they had raised, and, you know, they doubled the number of kids they were able to bring. So I don't know. I felt like that was a really cool way to, you know, introduce kids to science and not make it a thing that they can do that, you know, that's not some, you know, unattainable goal to be a developer and to, you know, work for NASA is a possibility that's within your reach. So I was impressed.
Haven't had a chance to see this film, but it's definitely on the must-see list for me. Everything I hear about is, you know, again, pro anybody can get into science, you know, especially under, you know, circumstances back then, right?
Well, you know what, sort of, I forget where I read this the other day, but I was thinking about this too. You know, this is a story based on history. These women, this was a real group of women who were just really, really good at math and, you know, helped NASA launch into space. Why did we see them in like Apollo 13? Or why did we see them in the right stuff? You know, it's like, well, how come it took this long for us to, I had never heard this story before the movie came out. And so it just kind of made me wonder, like, why did we never hear about them before now? You know, there's been so many movies about the space race. How come, you know, it took so long to get the word out about them?
And especially the themes of most of them, they're about achieving and inspiration, right?
Right. So. Right. And, you know, you're kind of figuring stuff out, like doing the math and, you know, Apollo 13, how much time do they spend, you know, trying to put things together and figure out what do they have in the space module and, you know, how can we get them home safely? And it was really about the science and math and, you know, all those things you want kids to get interested in. So it's kind of too bad that those movies didn't take a little bit more, you know, initiative and include these women who obviously did so much, you know, to help NASA get into space.
That's awesome. I definitely go see that. Yeah. It's probably, I imagine it's going to be a pretty quick turnaround to be on digital and home watching. They usually are for
award movies. Soon.
So probably look for it in like a month, probably.
Yeah, to do like a watch party or something.
That's awesome. And the article is over on Trib Live if you guys want to check it out.
Yep. Yeah, it's been up for a little bit. Like I said, even since I wrote it, they doubled the amount of money. I mean, they took the kids to the movies on last Monday, and like 700 kids to go to see this movie about, you know, getting math and going into space. So
that's awesome.
Cool that. Yeah.
Go check it out. Thanks. Katie.
Hi.
What's your awesome thing of the week?
Scary cats.
We got everything on this edition.
So this gentleman, Christopher Hess. Sorry, I mispronounced his name, I'm sure. It does an image-to-image translator. Essentially, it's a program that has been trained to recognize certain features in a photo and then translate it to a corresponding photo. So this was great. He did a building, a purse, shoes, but he also did the most important thing, cats. So you have to use this, if you go in, you have to open it up in Google Chrome, that thing over there, and let me find my little thing. And essentially, you go in a little box, and you draw a cat. There's a button you click on, clear, and then you draw a cat. The best of your ability, you have to give it a circles for eyes. It'll recognize circles for eyes, little pointy things for ears, little ends for tails, and then it'll give you an output of what the cat, they'll fill in a cat picture in your picture. So you can either make something that looks very much like a cat, or like everybody else, make some horrifying terror creature, which are just amazing. And then,
which is a cat too.
I know, it's so good. And the best part is if you,
what is that?
Yeah, I know. It's super horrifying.
Wait. So here's Garfield. Somebody drew Garfield, and it's not Garfield.
It's kind of Garfield. There's some fur.
It's kind of a cat in a blender. Wow.
So if you check out this gentleman Christopher's page, his Twitter account, there are some of he's tweeted some of his favorite ones, and they're hilarious. There's like an octopus cat, octo cat, there's a bat cat.
Box cat.
Yeah, there's pretty much, so it tries to guess what you're trying to draw, and it really doesn't look.
Some of these are really disturbing.
They're terrifying.
Especially when they start putting they just like have multiple eyes.
That's the scary ones.
Yeah, this three-eyed cat. So yeah, so check it out.
Somebody drew the farmer, the what do you call it? The husband and wife farmer. And they just
American Gothic.
Yes, American Gothic. It gets interesting. They just like put cat patterns in there. Wow. That's amazing.
So it's an image-to-image translation with clear TensorFlow implementation, I believe, is the whole phrase for it. Okay. The fancy, or just drawing funky cats.
Or cat funky cat generator. That's awesome.
Terrifying so cats.
You can check it out at afinelayer.com/pixsrv, or mm-hmm. P-I-X-S-R-V, to check that out.
Like I said, then, you have to go with Chrome. It doesn't work.
Yeah. It looks like it's just in Chrome. Mm-hmm. So thankfully, I'm in the right spot. So draw something interesting. Maybe you can draw that sword copter and see what comes out from there, right? Or you can draw a slice of pizza and see what happens from that. Our good friends Slice on Broadway, I'm going to give a shout out to them, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza. We really appreciate what those guys have been doing for us for a good while, and feeding the crew that comes in here. Kim, you got to get in and hang with us in one of these times. I know it's on the agenda, right? In 2017, resolution is to get in here. And
for no other reason than the pizza.
There you go. So please check it out. SliceOnBroadway.com, our good friends here down in Beachview, right along the tracks in Beachview and Main Street. Main Street down in Carnegie, PA, and PNC Park, home of the Pittsburgh Pirates. Let them know that the Awesome Cast sent you. Hit them up, PGH_Slice on the Twitter. And thanks again to those guys. All right. What do we have? Well, okay, speaking of more corporate food, I think we've talked about McDonald's doing this. But apparently Wendy's is going to plan, this is actually from CBS Pittsburgh, KDKA, our, some good friends over there, that they're going to add self-ordering kiosks to 1,000 locations. Oh, no, Flash Player.
That's what I was going to say. Please,
oh, no.
Dear CBS local, please leave Adobe Flash, because I have the same thing you do.
Oh, man. Somebody tweet shame CBS Pittsburgh, please, about that. I've tweet shamed them on some other pop-up issues. Well, this wonderful story that I can't show you.
Losers.
But no, they...
Did you Flash installed?
Actually, that's weird.
I'm still
because,
drawing pizza cats.
That's weird because I thought... I thought Chrome like auto installed. Did they quit that?
Yeah, everyone's leaving. No one will install.
But
that.
I thought like Chrome still had it like kind of their own built-in version of it.
I don't think they do have their own built-in version.
Anyways, with the still the story, they're going to be adding again very similar the tall self-ordering kiosk. You know, made popular to us locally with Sheetz, I think. It is an interesting turn from this. I post this and everybody's comment is like, oh, finally, I don't have to worry about, you know, talking to an employee that doesn't care about my order.
It's not talking to the employee that bothers me. It's the, I said no pickles. And by no pickles, I meant don't put pickles on my seat. Like, it's like they don't get it on the other side of the register.
Right.
But when you put it in, and that's why I love Sheetz. Because I've never had a wrong order or a wrong topping. I will say there sometimes the logic at Sheetz isn't that great, because if you like the Dr. Pepper sauce, it's only an option when you buy certain things. So then I have to buy two things because I want the Dr. Pepper sauce for thing A, but I know I have to buy thing B, so I have the option. So there is some errors in it, but I will say I've never gotten a wrong order.
Or as I experienced at Sheetz this weekend, I always, instead of getting the meatball sub, I get like the chicken sandwich, but put marinara sauce. It's like a meatball sub, but with chicken.
Mm-hmm.
And it's usually kind of prepared like a meatball sub. The marinara sauce is in there and everything. And they made it and put a dab of marinara on top of the sub. how long I've been doing this, and I'm like, that's not what I expected. So, but still, in general, like I think it's pretty cool as a customer experience. I think, you know, because It was great when I tried it in Thailand, for instance. We all, you go to Sheets because you don't have to do it. I started going to Sheets because the other, as another thread on Facebook is saying, Wawa Country Fair or our Sheets is a debate going on right now. You thought political debates were tough. That was getting pretty heavy. You know, Country Fair would be the thing where you go get your sub at a gas station and you wrote out, you know, he had to write out everything, right? Maybe you still do, but you're like, oh, I'd rather deal with the computer screen. Right. Mm-hmm. It's a reason to go to Wendy's, and it's for walk-ins. It doesn't look like it's going to be part of the drive-through, although that probably would be pretty good for them to do too, since, because, you know, drive-through technology. Oh no, is that a picture? Is that your pizza cat?
Yes, I just tweeted.
Oh, okay, pizza. Okay, I'll try to bring it up over here. But they've been trying it apparently already in Dublin, Ohio, and they're going to move forward, like I said, with 1,000 locations. No word exactly where those locations will be. But good chance I'm sure we'll get one or two of them around Pittsburgh. So probably whatever is about to get renovated next.
I wonder if they'll do it based on like how many customers are coming in per day. Because I'm thinking that would also speed up the lines.
Downtown.
But like,
downtown,
so I would think downtown would get one.
Yeah.
Even I mean, it's been recently renovated, but...
But these can't be too hard to implement, right? I'm thinking, like, well, the Wendy's we went to the other day over in Noblestown, like, there's a lot of space in that, like, kind of open order area, right? And mm-hmm. It's like tons of space. So I don't know. Or you just replace some of those giant screens that they have when you walk up at the one over on West Liberty, you know? So
or just make it where the cashier has the same kind of console. Obviously, right. It's probably a lot less user-friendly.
It was
just take that space that's on the counter and rip that thing out.
Well, and it depends, too, on how some of them are set up. Because, like, the McDonald's I was at, like, where you thought you would go up to order was just where they handed you your stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the new Wendy's have, like, order pickup spots and, you know, like, down the line. And some don't. So I think there's a little bit of configuration there. But no, it kind of makes sense. So from there, one of my notes weren't ready. There we go. That was actually shared by Andy Quayle up there, Techberg. We end up getting a lot of stuff from him. Well, the biggest thing, the less than awesome thing today, was this Dirta that shared this initially? This is from the Slack. I know he was telling us. So, who got affected by the Amazon downage?
Me.
Kim, did you see some of this?
Oh, we lost Kim.
Okay.
AWS took her out.
AWS apparently took her out. Well, I'll work on that. But Chilla, did you
yeah,
you
so,
know what happened here
so
with Amazon?
I actually noticed probably around noontime that I was trying to hit a couple web pages and websites to actually come up with show notes, and a lot of sites were either not loading.
And Gadget was gone.
Yeah, it was gone. It was off the face of the earth.
Yeah.
And then shortly thereafter that, in the Google News threads, I started to see Amazon AWS services was down. And I mean, this impacts Pinterest. I think it impacted Uber. I mean, it impacted a lot of different companies. And the one thing, I guess, Apple still has a number of a portion of their services on AWS still.
Right. They've been billing a lot out, but there's still a lot of space. Kim's back.
Kim's back.
Kim,
sorry.
Kim, did you get taken out? Did you get taken out by the Amazon Web Services?
No, you know what? It's not even that time. I kicked over my router.
Oh,
that'll do it.
A dork.
Technology.
Exactly.
Awesome.
I
know Nest, like, I couldn't view my Nest camera at home. Mm-hmm. Like, there was a lot of services that just were gone.
You know how I've been moving over all the podcasts to a new server, mm-hmm. our new host? It apparently runs on Amazon Web Services, fireside.fm. Although it was great because it came back and said, hey, we're back up. And I left you guys a present in a dashboard, and he updated it. And now there's podcast achievements over on their dashboard. Which I really appreciate. So,
with Scarehouse,
you had some interesting stuff.
We lost
all
the images
yeah.
on our website, which this is good user tip for you at home. Be aware of what you name your images, because if this happens, occasionally just the name of the image will pop up. So if you have a name, yeah, which everything we were had, okay, everything was like meeting, you know, very generic names, but the little, you know, the little tag you have for your image to identify it when you're online may pop up if your images go away like this. I was like, oh crud, we don't have anything named something goofy, do we?
Wow. Yeah. I said like ticketing and everything was kind of wonky.
Yeah. I had text everywhere, a couple little squares. And then, like I said, the words. For them.
We had, so thankfully our front end stuff isn't anywhere. Like even the service for the hosting, I could go in there and look at stuff. But I think just serving the files was a problem. And even our indiewrestling.us, I recently, since we had some problems with GoDaddy, moved over all that content to Amazon Web Services. And of course, within 2 months, we go down. But
Pokemon runs on Amazon Web Services.
Did it?
I found that out. Yeah. Someone said that was, yeah, and I noticed constant crashes today, this afternoon in the game.
I had it like just on next to me while I was working, and I didn't notice I wasn't seeing anything pop up.
Maybe it uses Google services.
I think it'd be Google since
it is using Google services.
Atlantic and everything, right?
Yeah. So. Yeah, I'm sorry. Retract that statement.
You were just crashing in general.
I was just crashing in general.
Yeah, it was just you.
Too many Gen 2 Pokemon.
Too many Gen 2. Yeah. So there were some good comments. I know Marco Arman and a few others on Twitter were discussing, you know, hey, this isn't a slight. Every service goes down. How many times has Google suffered major outages? Our friend Riz says, hey, so about this Amazon thing, our entire business apparently runs on it. So he had problems today, right? You know, we've seen the same thing with Mass Comcast and Verizon outages in regions. And again, like I've had those where I've gone into work and was like, okay, well, we can do our work, but we can't deliver it to anybody because of our services.
I did see on their status page, it was mainly the eastern side of the U.S.
Yeah,
like they're Virginia, like they're based on, yeah. Mm-hmm. I did see, so I'm not sure what it was like on the West Coast, but for the... For us East Coasters here in Eastern Standard Time, it kind of sucked.
Well, since we're very Pittsburgh, you know, based kind of thing, that makes sense.
Let me tell you who's whining the loudest, though, was journalists on Twitter who couldn't get onto Slack. Were like freaking the hell, like it was as if their world had ended and they forgot how to be journalists without being able to send each other emojis on Slack. It was just the most, honestly, journalist Twitter is a very strange and whiny place a lot of the time. You know, it's either congratulations on the new job or I can't believe you wrote this story or oh my God, Slack is down. Those are kind of your three areas of so, yeah, a lot of whining today, but I can't get on Slack. So that's, you know.
I didn't realize Adobe runs on AWS. So I wonder, like, what was it like if you were trying to use their Creative Cloud? I guess it's just you weren't using their Creative Cloud.
I must have danced around a lot of these because Slack mostly worked for me, at least like in functioning. That's where we were talking about this was on Slack today.
But that was after.
But you're saying,
I sent you a photo and it's still like pending.
Yeah, like photos weren't working, so maybe it was just portion. Right. I was in Adobe Audition today. Thankfully, I wasn't using cloud components to it, but it didn't like say, hey, you can't connect or anything like that. So yeah, I kind of slid around. Thankfully, I just had my head down editing locally. So that wasn't such a big deal, but still, like, I'm glad that it happened then and not like tonight when I have to post all this stuff, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I've had those before with other services that are, you know, questionable maybe. And again, you know, free services too. And I think this is, you know, Kim, you brought up like kind of everybody kind of responding to, oh crap, this is down. You know, these things are great tools and everything. And I'm, you know, it's kind of that worry that people talk about people becoming too dependent, you know, and there should be a, you know, I just hate the attitude when something like this comes up and people kind of throw their hands up and like, well, guess I'm not getting work done today. So, well, then, you know, what work can you do? You know, like a lot of times this would happen and we're like, well, wait a minute. We have a lot of projects sitting on our hard drives to work on, you know, on the video side of things. Or what can I write something up in WordPad if I don't have Office, you know, and we can just put it on the cloud later when it gets back up, right? Or pick up the phone if Hangouts isn't working. You know,
like we have no survival skills. If one thing goes down, it's like, oh no, head for the bunker, you know, like And there's other ways to do work. Just, you know, have a little creativity, or, you know, try to, I don't know, get so dependent on your free services and your, you know.
Well, I understand that, but there are some companies that have gone cloud only.
Yeah.
So if you, yeah. I mean, one of the ones that I can think of is Stitch Fix, that's based out of Pittsburgh.
Mm-hmm.
They're all hosted. There's, aren't it's all web driven.
Aren't they a sock?
No,
company?
It's a women's fashion. It's like you buy a box. It's like a box of the month, but it's all clothes.
Okay.
They started doing.
I think they were giving out socks at an event.
They might have been giving out socks at an event. Okay. But they're all. I mean, there's all their employees. It's all through a browser.
Think. What if you're remote? Our friends, they just changed their names. I can't remember it right now, but the former 8-Bit Evolution that we talked to and Awesome chatted on the show, they are on Slack coordinating, working on their games with people around the world, like the very, you know, decentralized kind of thing. Service like this go down. It is a productivity loss.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's kind of a thing we should expect to happen. Technology goes down. Things break, right? You know, I always caution people when they're like, you know, but I'm using all this stuff. It should be easier, right? I'm like, no, it should be maybe efficient when you learn to use it or it works. But, like, there needs to be kind of a expectation of things to fail. That, I don't know. That's kind of my idea of things. Or maybe that's because of how I work around things. Look what happened before this when Skype didn't work. you know, things like that. I think more people, do need to pick up the, hey, what do I do when technology doesn't work? Skill set. So,
yeah.
All right. Training. Let's bring it back around to things that are working or may work in the near future. Hey, let's go tiny. I was excited to see this. You guys know that I've been experimenting with some Raspberry Pi stuff. It's my security camera. That's how I know there was somebody at the front door yesterday to let me know that my package was delivered to the wrong place. That's when I know whenever, like, Katie's sneaking into the studio. We're always interested in kind of what, you know, they keep pushing it. About a year ago, they released a Raspberry Pi Zero for a $5 computer. So cheap that they put it in the front cover of their Magpie magazine. I tried really hard to find one of those and was very unsuccessful in doing that. Now they have a new one that's $10 and includes Wi-Fi. So now I'm on the search for this guy. They're also having official Raspberry Pi cases for it, so I don't have to get these really sketchy ones off of Amazon anymore. So I really appreciate that. Like, this may actually replace what I'm using for my webcam security cam thing. If this thing's, it seems like it would be powerful enough because it's a gigahertz processor and everything. Again, kind of going towards that, you know, easy ways to get your kids to start coding or at least play Minecraft and get off your TV. Or like the guy that got a monitor from me and he's throwing emulators on it and just wanted, or hit DOS, a DOS emulator on this stuff to play old games. It's a really cool kind of option for that. And again, it starts at only $10 now for, and you literally get the board, like that circuit board. That's it to start with. And maybe a power cord? No, I think you gotta get a power cord separate, but it's usually, I don't know what it is for this. Yeah, it should be USB. It should be like a micro USB, like your Android phones. So cool to see that they're updating that. I'm hoping to get my hands on one. Again, $10. It's like, it's going to be jacked up because of accessibility on Amazon, probably a little bit. But other than that, like, if you can just find it from a distributor, it's a $10 computer and you can start playing with it and you can make your own IoT devices or webcams or emulators or whatever you want to do with it.
The other thing, I've seen a lot of people use these as just a Plex box. So if you run a Plex server in your house, mm-hmm. Now you've kind of pushed that to every TV.
Have they done? Because I was looking at, so I've been digging a little bit into my Steam collection again, and you can get these boxes for about $20, and then you have to pay. I think for $50 you can get the box and the controller, and like your PC or Mac sits somewhere on the network. But this is the thing you plug into your TV, much like Plex, right?
Mm-hmm.
And now you're playing your high-end PC game remotely to your TV in your living room,
mm-hmm.
Right? Like, is there like, I don't expect you to have the answer to it, but I wonder if there's like a Steam OS thing I can throw on one of these to do that. you know, it's a $10 computer. It has to be a roughly equivalent to what those boxes are doing, right?
Yeah, that I don't know. But Google might.
Find out, Google. Steam OS. There's a research there. If anybody out there knows any info on that. So.
Pi 3.
It would simply, but you'd also, you know, even if I could just plug in like an Xbox controller, because I'm not really sold on the Steam ones. But anyways, science. NASA, speaking of NASA earlier, Kim was bringing up, we found three Earth-sized planets just 40 light years away. These are, from what I was reading from when this came out last week, they are closer to their sun than Mercury is for us. At least the ones that can they think that will sustain life. Their star is smaller and younger, so it'll be around long after ours is. So I think this is the right time for this, with a lot of the, you know.
I have already got my ticket. And
are you one of them on the SpaceX trip?
I can't discuss that, maybe I might be.
But this
that's pretty wild. Two people paying tickets to get on Elon Musk's flight around the moon. Like, I'm dying to know who it is. I think one of them has to be, I don't know, like Richard Branson or somebody like that. Like some crazy billionaire, right?
But Branson's doing his own, isn't he? Isn't Virgin?
Yeah, that's true. You're right.
Yeah, like, right. That seems like a little bit of industrial interworking there.
Yeah,
a little bit.
Sabotage
me. I mean, I could imagine a Bill Gates. You know, I mean, it's somebody. What I mean, you're gonna know. I don't think they're gonna be able to keep it secret through whenever they go up in, like, what is it, 2018? They're going, second quarter of 2018, so just over a year from now. On the Crew Dragon spacecraft. So we found new planets and we're sending more people to the ones close to us. I think that's a good step or two forward in the space. I don't know. Is it even a race anymore? You know, on top of that, was it India put up like 140 satellites in one rocket? You know, kind of like some kind of record on that. So wait, what is this? I'm sorry. I just saw something advertised next to this that says Amazon S3 outage 2017, how to watch it online. Like that sounds very Fox News of them. Wow.
It's just people crying in the corner. No! What's wrong with my website?
What's wrong with my slide?
I can't find it. Just sobbing journalists.
Yeah, sobbing.
You can't journalist without it.
What's a pen and paper? But anyways, no, I think it's some really cool forward things going on there in the space world. From there, oh geez, so much on here tonight. Katie, Snapchat is changing. Somebody brought this up to me the other day.
Snapchat. Users getting older, no longer hip and cool with kids. No, they're seeing more older users.
Finally.
Now we'll show you. We'll go wherever you're at and overtake it. And then you'll move on to something else. And then we'll find that. You can't get away from us old folks. We'll find you. But they contribute it mostly to Snapchat's content deals, like the NFL, NBC Universal, Disney. So they're seeing a lot more of that. And I think that's why a lot more people are heading over there for that unique content, at least the older folks. It's easy to use that. You can find that easily on your Snapchat. But they said, where's the number? Their growth, what is it? 6.4% of Snapchat users are between the ages of 45 and 54, which is up from the 4.2% that they thought it was. So it's even older than I thought it was. It's not even us. It's even older than us. Maha! I can't find the kids' number, but it definitely, they said it dropped.
So this changes if you're in social media and you want, you know, you're like, well, I need Snapchat because I need to get that age bracket, yes. Right? But now you get to skew that a little bit older, right?
Yeah, it's one of those things where you're like, this was a lot of marketers were thinking that this is my direct pathway to the kids, the millennials, and it's not necessarily anymore, and it may have never been for your company, but just because a lot of people put it under the assumption that it was only the younger people using it. I personally love Snapchat. I've been using it a lot more because it requires the least amount of work for me. I just snap a photo, I snap a video, and it's up and out there. and I don't have to worry about putting up words to it, like on Instagram, which is another photo-based social media platform. But
have you been altering that with the Snapchat-like features of Instagram?
No, because the thing is it's either my options are either Snapchat or Instagram video, you know, at that moment, you know, if I got to choose between the two. And I end up most times doing Snapchat. And then if I really like it, I download the story. And then depending on how long I have the story for each section, you know, each of the snippets of the story, there's apps that speed it up. So I don't have to worry about, you know, of 8 seconds here and that's too long. But it just, that's what I do primarily. Like I said, if I have a good story.
I did like that when I feel like, didn't they change it recently? Because whenever they did their save stories options, it started getting like one step too complicated for me, and I kind of bowed out of it. And that's when Instagram was picking up. But like I can't like throw the stories together in one video when I download them on Instagram yet. Like I was able to on Snapchat. Mm-hmm. Like that was really nice. Mm-hmm. Now I actually have to pull it into iMovie and stitch them together real quick, and then do it. So again, another step. Right. So,
but you can tell this is where Instagram's taking a hit at Snapchat. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure they're going to figure it out with the whole story snip stitching. So they're not going to have to, you're going to be in there versus over at Snapchat.
Mm-hmm. From the chat room, BC Steele says he just got his hands on the Gear 360.
Uh-oh.
And was asking if anybody had personal experience with it. Do we? You're talking to
there's
the
one right above your head.
There's one. No.
Oh, the Gear 360.
The camera.
Yes.
Well, the camera. Well, of course, you had one. You got one as well.
I have a camera.
You had it like before anybody else. All the cool kids had it on pre-release, and we got to play with that. That was one of the things we tried when we did the Scarehouse 360, right? Mm-hmm. I believe the final result we ended up using was the Ricoh Theta.
Correct.
But we were trying to do stuff in low light with that one, so it got a little funky. I think generally we like it, the resolution on it, better than the Ricoh for video, right? Mm-hmm. So I don't know.
The one thing I will still say about the Samsung Gear 360, and I can tell they're continuing to work on it. The metadata doesn't always come through well, so things like the Facebook 360 photo,
and
really have to be careful about how you upload that.
Yeah, I had trouble bringing it over to the Mac. It didn't like the formats or anything like that. That's one of the other reasons I kind of went for the Ricoh. Like one of the many reasons I went for the Ricoh footage when we did the finalize for the Scarehouse and some other projects. I mean, as long as you're in that Samsung world, and obviously he is because he got it from Verizon probably alongside his phone. It just, you know, if you're doing anything beyond that, it's might be a little too heady for that, a little too restrictive. So, but have fun with it. Stick it different places. I think he knows we did some 360 video around a cage match, last August that actually he may be in now that I think about it. So, you know, just kind of like, you know, work on some ideas with it, and you can put anything to Facebook, and it's really cool. So, it's getting to that point where, 360 and VR stuff is just popping up and advertising stuff all over the place. Like it's coming back around. So, I have another local story, and this one seems to work in, CBS's Flash Player. I don't know. I don't think we got into this one. There's a Wired article that came up probably a week or so ago. But there is a, I think I got another story playing here actually. Than what we're talking about. But there's local companies that are laid off coal miners are being trained to write computer code as that next thing. And the Wired article discussed about, you know, kind of this is the new blue collar job, you know, and you know, you're not, you know, I kind of commented, you're not too old to learn this stuff. You know, there's people all walks of life that are going into like the Code Academy up there in Allentown and come out with, you know, starts of new careers, right? And as things are going away, it's a really cool way to modernize that kind of stuff. And this is saying more than 30,000 coal miners have lost their jobs, and they're trying to, you know, put some of them back to work in that. So thinking about a lot of those jobs, like I know a lot of foundry work and everything is very math based, right? My father was a machinist and had to deal with a lot of that. So I think, like, again, if he was kind of at another spot of his career, like, this is something that could be, you know, potentially picked up on with the right training. So
Yeah, for sure. It seems a lot more realistic than, you know, oh, we're going to bring those coal jobs back. You know, that there's a finite amount of coal, after all, you know, ever in the world. So, you know, what's our plan when we finally do run out of coal? You know, how do we, you know, transition people who, you know, have been in that field their whole lives? It's sort of unrealistic to say all those jobs are going to come back, right? So if they're not, there's got to be a plan B. And I feel like coding is such a good skill to have no matter what your career is.
Mm-hmm.
No matter what you're planning to do.
In reaction to one of the stories we had earlier, you know, you could say, well, all those jobs are from Wendy's maybe are going to start to go away because there's not going to need as many people to register, right? Yeah, but somebody still got to work on the kiosk. Somebody still has to service that, that be a coding or something else kind of right. deal. So,
well, it's interesting because, you know, I remember a friend of mine, I forget who told me this, but whenever the president or whenever a politician comes to, you know, visit like Google Pittsburgh or to visit, you know, like, you know, a place where they're doing technology and they have robots, you know, they're doing things that are automated. They never want to put that on camera for like the photo op because everyone kind of equates, well, robots are taking away your jobs. But I feel like we've almost done a disservice, right? By not showing that, you know, robots can be, you know, there's jobs associated with robotics. And I mean, obviously we've in Pittsburgh are a good example of that, right? So, you know, we should be showing, not saying that, you know, robots are going to take your job away or we don't want to have anything be automated. You know, these potentially are making jobs safer for people. So you're not doing these really heavy manual labor jobs that maybe a robot can do, but it doesn't mean that there's going to be a net loss of jobs necessarily. And I think we kind of lose sight of that sometimes. You're right. It's someone has to program the computer at Wendy's. You know, someone has to write the code to make sure that the computer knows what pickles are versus, you know, what other, you know, food's going to go on your burger or whatever. So I think we kind of lose sight of that. That's a good conversation to sort of make sure people remind people of.
And a lot of jobs that are safer. You know, I don't think we should, you know, cry at the loss of jobs where people are getting hurt, where, you know, I worked in safety training. I've seen the result of what these jobs bring, you know, if they're going to replace, you know, if our biggest injury is carpal tunnel and replacement, I think that's a good move, you know, in the long run. So just make sure everybody has a good exercise plan. But anyways, but it'll be interesting to see how that develops over the next several years. So speaking of 360 cams, bringing that back around. And by the way, BC says thanks. He's going to wear it on as a helmet cam to the ring here very soon. So I can't wait to see that. You say Rico has a new camera there, Chilla.
Yes, they have actually come out with a camera that's capable of a direct video stream at 2K and 30 frames per second. One of the things they were very careful about was keeping the device at approximately the same size. Oh, and it'll stream continuously for 24 hours.
It looks more grippy.
Yeah,
which was a problem with the first one.
It does look more grippy. They were interested in keeping it the same size or smaller. It looks like it's about the same size. Maybe with the grippiness, it's a little thicker, but I don't think that's actual like core device. I think it's to make it grippy. But they've actually allowed for the micro SD card slot. And instead of having onboard.
Thank you. That was one of my biggest complaints between that and the placement of the ports on the bottom. So if I screwed it on a tripod, I couldn't connect power or HDMI to it.
So now the ports are on the side.
Oh,
geez. They learned so much.
Can I trade mine in?
I don't think so.
Does anybody want to buy Hey, BC, do you want to buy a second 360 camera?
It does retail right now. Pre-orders are $499 per camera.
Which I think it was about $350-ish for the one I have.
Okay.
So
with what you're getting, I could see the price dropping over time.
Of course.
But I think it's nice, again, to see another company moving forward with the technology. It is set to arrive this spring, so it's probably right around the corner from a delivery perspective. They are calling it the Rico R Developer Kit, but you can, like I said, pre-order that now. I'm guessing because they're touting it as a developer kit, it's probably going to get cheaper. What they're going to do to it, who knows? I know when Samsung went with the Gear VR Developer Kit, the difference between the production version and the dev kit version was the dev kit only fit one very specific phone and the final version was near identical, but mm-hmm. it fit a multitude of phones.
Right.
And then their third generation got thinner, lighter, etc. So I'm guessing it's probably going to be the same type of thing with this. I don't think they're going to pare down the specs. They're not going to move the ports back to the bottom. They're not going to remove the card slot. But again, it's just nice to see them pushing the technology forward, and it, obviously there's demand for it.
Oh yeah, definitely. This is going to be the next thing, and as we talked about, like, you know, I think it's only a matter of time before this becomes, you know, part of our phones doing, you know, things like this too. I've had conversations with some journalists about like what they could do on the scene, taking pictures, taking footage, you know, and being able to use that, whether, you know, for TV or on the web or anything like that. Kim, have you looked at cameras like this as possibilities in the work that you do?
I think that the trouble is that, you know, for someone like me who's independent, you know, it's more of a cost issue. If you're at a shop in a newsroom, you know, that's, you know, they can absorb those costs more readily. I think the learning curve on this kind of thing for journalists, you would be surprised at how high it would be. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of journalists who, you know, reporters and editors are a little resistant to, do photography or do video because they feel like they have people in their shop that can do that better than them. You know, they don't want to put out something that they feel isn't, good quality. And then there's other people that don't want to learn new skills. Surprise, surprise. But I think, you know, as the price points come down or as there is, you know, there's good organizations that are doing a lot of stuff to train journalists, like the Online News Association, which I'm part of. Last year at the conference, everyone wanted to try on the VR headset. Everyone wanted to see what everyone was going on. But you go back to your own newsroom or you go back to your own kind of your own journalism practice, whatever. And it's not always possible to do it, you know, as a solo person. But there's so many cool things going on. The people that are doing it are being really creative beyond what I think even, you know, you could envision. That's the thing. Like, so how could I justify the cost? How could I justify the expense? What would the story be? Mm-hmm. You know, and I think that's what newsrooms kind of defeat themselves a little bit. Rather than kind of going out and experimenting with it, you know, they get a little bit like, oh, well, we have to justify that it's going to bring us this amount of revenue, or we're going to win an award or whatever, you know. So they kind of stop themselves before they start with new technology. And I think this is no different, you know. So it's going to be a little while before, you know, the rate of adapting is, you know, significant. I think it's the big guys are doing that stuff now, but, you know, medium-sized organizations are still kind of nervous about spending money, unfortunately.
Yeah, it definitely has to be that little bit of experiment phase. And that's kind of why we dived into it, because we're like, we had a hunch that there'd be a lot to it. And seeing the response we did have from, and I played a little bit here of, what we did with Scarehouse. I mean, there's the response, if you do something cool in the space with this, people are definitely reacting to something like that, you know, with okay. Facebook and YouTube. So, it's definitely finding that spot, right? So,
yeah. Yep.
Awesome.
And I just saw on TechCrunch a tweet, people now watch 1 billion hours of YouTube per day.
1 billion. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Is that with the YouTube TV that they were talking about? Juggalo John sent over from that. I did not see the announcement for YouTube TV. I did hear that the YouTube, like Apple TV app, got updated. So I don't know.
The aggregate.
Let me see if I can pull up what they might be talking about in there. But
I'm sure they're trying to maintain their market share. Because I know Facebook has been announcing and spreading like wildfire with Facebook Live and Facebook mm-hmm. Video. So I'm sure they're going to be continuing to try to make a push with
their existing. YouTube TV is going to be a $35 a month plan for up to 6 accounts, expected launch. It's going to include 40 networks. So this is, YouTube is basically doing a Sling TV, DirecTV Now kind of thing. So there's, I think cable is kind of obsolete now, because, you know, as long as you have good internet, because now this is going to be the third major, actually fourth major player with PlayStation, DirecTV, and Sling, which is Dish Network, putting out major stuff. And this is going to be channels, broadcast channels and cables like USA, FX, Freeform, ESPN, Fox Sports, NBC Sports. So yeah, that's probably their kind of answer for, you know, Google Fiber being too hard to roll out everywhere, because you need to physically roll out fiber everywhere, right? So they've tried their hands at that. Maybe that's where they'll get to that. YouTube TV will also include the ability to record, so you'll have DVR in there as well. So according to this, so it makes sense. I mean, how many of us have Chromecasts in our homes at this point, right? So it's already kind of serviceable, and I'm sure it'll be everywhere in the long run too. It's all those Android devices, right? So all right, guys, I think that's all the awesome we can fit into a show for today. We have a lot of other stories in there. You can check our Awesome Cast Facebook group, or check the notes that we link over on the awesomecast.net along with this, including things like watch us on your Samsung TV.
Yeah, so that's what I was saying. So Facebook's really made a push at their apps and their app catalog. Mm-hmm. So you can watch us now on, if you have a Samsung smart TV, there's actually a Facebook video app in there.
Well, and
so
also, you can watch us on there. You can also pull up the video in Chromecast or AirPlay it too.
Mm-hmm.
So I've been doing that. Whenever my USA Network app crashed on the Chromecast, I always try to queue up something else. And we're watching Giraffe Cam from pregnant Giraffe.
We're on
Cam
like day seven.
Day seven. I didn't know. It was just the thing that I was playing, and Missy like told me all about it. And I'm like, this is a thing that's happening? And I got informed. So,
I honestly have to thank Justine Russo for that on Twitter, because she and her love of giraffes, it was like everywhere.
Okay. That's it. Okay. So I learned about the giraffes as I fixed my wrestling. Anyways, thank you. Kim, thank you so much for joining us.
Well, thanks for having me. Anytime.
Where can people find you? And tell them again where to find your podcast.
Yeah, so the podcast is The Broadcast Podcast. You can find it on iTunes, broadcast-podcast.com. And you can find me all over the place, a little bit of here, a little bit there, the Trib, City Paper, you know, a little bit of this, a little bit of that, working on some different things. And yeah, you can find me on Twitter pretty much all the time. It's Social Kimley. So
there you go. Check it out. Katie Dudas at K Dudders on the Twitter.
Hi.
Scarehouse Podcast.
Mm-hmm. I was actually posting on a friend's page that someone needs to buy www.didthatgiraffegivebirthyet.com and just put a big yes or no.
that reminded me back to the Amazon web story that the what was the site, like the site that you is the site down or something like that, like that was a status for all services, was also down because it's on Amazon
down for me, or I think it's down for me, or is it down for everyone or something like that.
Yeah,
it was
yeah. Down. So that was a nice little piece of irony. Chilla at Chilla on the Twitters,
that's where you can find me. Come chat. Let's have words.
We'll send your gadget questions over to him. He gets his hands on a lot of the stuff that maybe he can't even tell us about.
Hopefully we'll get to see a Galaxy S8 here in an upcoming episode. We'll see.
There you go. So go check it out. And I'm at Sorgatron on the Twitter, sorgatronmedia.com. Check out a lot of the podcasts going on there. MikeSorg.com, the link to everything else. And see you on the internets as well. Until next time, you know, check us out live.awesomecast.net. Yeah, so where whatever technology we're using, even though it's a Facebook Live these days, you can jump into the chat room there and join us 7 p.m. Eastern time every Tuesday over there, and follow us, subscribe, awesomecast.net. Thank you so much to our awesome chat room, like BC Steele, like Wheels, Amanda checking in on her break, Tragar, and the rest. You've been our awesome audience. Have an awesome week. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com.